Stephanie TeSlaa. I work at Crossroads Bible Church alongside my husband Mark, and we lead the marriage ministry. And we want to just introduce a tool that we use quite often in marriage, but it's definitely applicable for relationships. We refer to it as the houses. Before we get into talking about the houses, I want to give a little bit of a kind of backup and a premise to what we're looking at. In life, I think no one would argue with the fact that we have a mind, we have emotions, and we have a will. Your mind is your thinker, your emotions, your feeler, and your will is your chooser. And what often happens is the mind drives the emotions drive the will, and then your will, when you get to a chooser, we choose between Christ or doing things ourselves, if we are Christians. Oftentimes I see that the mind and the emotions, you can see the graphic has got arrows going both directions, that sometimes the mind fuels the emotions and sometimes then the emotions fuel the mind. So let's just break these down a second. The mind is composed of your thoughts and your beliefs, and this is where we draw conclusions about ourselves, others, and God. Our emotions are not necessarily a bad thing. We're created in the image of God, and you can see throughout the Bible that God does show emotion, so they're not a bad thing. They're oftentimes a reflection of what we believe or what we think. They're not a source of truth, although sometimes we choose to live out that source of truth. And emotions really are not the problem. They point to something deeper, and we'll come back to that. And then want to say something about this. We call it the flesh. You can call it coping mechanisms. You can call it self. Sometimes biblical translations say sinful nature. It's basically our way of doing life apart from Christ. And you can categorize oftentimes our flesh patterns or our coping mechanisms in self-promotion or self-protection. So we'll come back to that a little bit. And we oftentimes will ask people when they come in to meet with us, or it's very evident that the fruit of their life at that point is conflict, frustration, exhaustion. We talked a little bit about that in class. If you are living a life that's choosing Christ, oftentimes that's exhibited in peace, even in the midst of conflict. So when we talk about houses, you have to give thought to the fact that we're going to be tackling what are the thoughts or what are the beliefs going on, what are the emotions that you're feeling, and then what are the ways in which you're choosing to live apart from Christ. So when we get into the houses demonstration, we are going to be looking at those three components in myself and then also in Mark.
And I'd like to do just a quick example of this also, just to kind of put our minds in the right spot before we head to a kind of a complex housing situation. So mind, I may think in my mind that I'm a good husband. And with those thoughts, you know, I might feel a certain way about myself. So when Steph comes to me and says, you know, could you really be a little bit more helpful maybe around the house? If my typical response to that is defensiveness and being critical, I might want to evaluate my thought process. I feel a certain way. Why am I feeling a certain way? Because I probably have a too high of an expectation, or thinking too highly of myself, a little bit too much pride in the type of husband I am. And so it's not so much that I'm choosing the wrong thing and I just got to change my behavior and my, or even my feelings. I can't feel this way anymore. No, I got to go all the way back to my mind. Maybe I shouldn't take myself so seriously. Maybe there's an opportunity for me to grow as a husband. And so that's just a real quick analysis or overview of what we're going to be getting at with our houses.
One more thing we often say to couples, what if the arguments that you have, whether it's in marriage, whether it's with other people, aren't really about the finances or about the children or about X, Y, and Z? What if there's something deeper going on? And we even see this sometimes in our positive actions. You know, you can talk about love languages and making sure that Mark is speaking my love language. We've had instances in our marriage where he's speaking a certain love language to me, but it's all for the wrong reasons. So this is where we're going to talk about kind of the deeper meaning.
Okay.
We're going to introduce our houses to you. This is obviously a moment of vulnerability where you get to know the deep, dark secrets of the worst possible Stephanie and the worst possible Mark. Thanks be to God that this is not the way we operate day in and day out in our marriage. There were times where we did quite often, and it was a much more time of conflict. So my common thoughts and feelings, you can see here, I'm going to pick up a pen. Overwhelmed is probably one of my biggest feelings, especially when stress is coming at me. And when we're talking about houses, we're oftentimes talking about those times of extreme stress, because in stress, you are going to be the worst you possible. So overwhelmed, edgy, tense, misunderstood or misjudged, frustrated and guarded were very common thoughts and feelings. And then we come down at the base of our house, the foundation of our house, is our belief system. And for me, this one right here is probably my biggest lie slash belief, is I'm on my own. Another one is I'm not the problem. I am what I do. This comes across a lot in, if I get an A in a class, that means I'm a great person. If I get an E in the class, I'm a really bad person. I'm strong and competent is another one, and I am right. So when I have these feelings, and these are the beliefs that are going through my head, these are the weapons that I pick up and I throw at people who may be in the midst of the conflict with me. So you will see me get defensive, critical, push and pull. Push and pull is an interesting thing. With relationships in particular, my relationship with Mark, I want to be in relationship with him, so I will please him, I will do things for him to get him to want to be with me. And then if he lets me down in some way or doesn't meet expectations, I will then push him away. Part of it comes back to this, I'm on my own. If I can't trust you or you've let me down, I'm going to push you away. Bossy, I have no peace. I get very frantic. I will get to a point of avoiding and silence that comes usually later down the road. That's not my first line of defense. And then control is usually through manipulation for me. And then stubborn. So those are the worst Stephanie possible.
And then for myself, I know when I shared this with Steph for the first time, she was kind of blown away about what was going on in my head, because I'm not one to verbalize either my feelings or my thoughts very quickly. But she would have never guessed this is what is kind of a baseline of feelings for me. Foolish, stupid, misunderstood, especially that one there, inadequate. I come from a family that I am a big time trailer. I'm 10 to 15 years younger than all of my siblings, and I could see myself always trying to measure up to them. I wasn't, you know, included in a lot of things, especially early on when I was young, and so I always felt like I needed to achieve more and be as good as them in order to be able to hang out with them. So I think this underlying inadequacy was one that was in me for a long time. I just didn't share that with anybody. And then controlled. Then we go down to the beliefs, and probably my number one is I can't get it right. It's hard to explain what that actually is, but at times it just feels like no matter what I do, it's just either doesn't measure up in my mind to what I think I should have done or how well I should have done something. Or if somebody just speaks critically to me, and it could be constructive criticism, I just feel like the whole thing is wrong. So I just can't get it right. I don't measure up. I'm inadequate. Kind of goes along with my feeling. And then I'm not the problem. And you can probably see that this might be a problem in our marriage right there, when both of us never think that we're the problem. And then the tools that I use, lie and minimize. It's not like I'm a compulsive liar. I just try not to say anything that might ruffle anybody's feathers. So that means that I might just avoid the thing completely. In other words, I don't bring up things. I'm not assertive enough, or at least assertive as I should be. So I can manipulate to kind of get my way. Steph kind of alluded to that a little earlier. Please be critical, defensive, and self-righteous. So this whole pleasing thing, people sometimes feel like, well, how is that a bad thing? It is a bad thing because we'll want to make sure that everything's okay so that I'm okay. And with that, I can manipulate people. This is the weapon that I choose when I want to please somebody, is I'm not really concerned about what might be right, but I'm more concerned about, I just don't want anything to be lots of waves or lots of emotions. So I'm just looking to make sure that everything's okay and peaceful in the house, and that can be an issue when you have kids, because they are not predictable, and so I can control or manipulate them just so I feel better about myself.
I do want to give one word. This demonstration called The Houses, we actually were taught this through Teresa Slabicorn at Life Center in Grand Rapids, so just want to give her credit for this little tool that she introduced to us years ago that we find extremely useful. So now you see maybe a little bit of the conflict that Mark and I go through. However, we're going to actually go through a demonstration of a beautiful, beautiful argument that we had several years ago, just to show you an illustration of what this looks like. Because when we get married, or when you're in relationship with people, your houses kind of get combined. And Mark's going to choose to pick up weapons and lob them at me, and oftentimes those lobs hit something deep in my foundation that trigger me to pick up and then lob something back to him, and oftentimes what I lob back to him then reinforces a lie in his foundation, and we get this crazy cycle that goes between us. And so we're going to give an illustration.
So it all starts off with me going to the mailbox one afternoon, grabbing the mail, and finding a bill that I had totally forgot about. It was a car issue that we had that month, and I had forgotten that we had to pay that this month. And in the back of my mind, I want to be a good provider. I don't want to feel inadequate. And so in that case, what I chose to do was, is I took the mail, made some decisions on my own. I just said, hey, we're going to make it work. You know, we'll eat ramen noodles for the month. We'll do whatever it takes. But I'm not going to share this information with Steph. I'm actually going to withhold this information because I can handle it. I want to please her. I'm probably manipulating the situation, or you could say I'm avoiding
or minimizing. Yeah. So what we do is we show he ends up lobbing a brick over to me. We put a brick in between. And what these bricks are symbolizing is a wall that's going up in our intimacy, whether that's intimacy of communication, intimacy in all regards in our relationship. So what happens next, and actually this lob didn't necessarily hit anything in my foundation because I wasn't even aware of what was going on. But I came to Mark and I said, hey babe, we're going to Israel and I need to get some hiking boots and I need some new ones. They've got to be comfortable. And the fact that we're walking in the desert day in and day out, I want to make sure I get nice ones.
And of course, I haven't told her anything yet, so I have to keep that on ground level underneath everything. So I choose to just say, okay, we can make this work, and I've got a coupon. I know where we can go to get a deal. So that, again, makes me feel at least good enough to be able to be in control of that situation and manipulate that situation enough where I'm feeling okay about the decision to go buy some hiking boots.
Are you feeling frustrated at this point, a little?
Maybe a little anxious.
Okay, so he's feeling anxious. We're going to go ahead and just call that like another lob, because once again, he's not letting me in on what is going on in his mind. So the story evolves. We go to an outlet, and I shopped in the women's section, and Mark shopped in the
discount section.
The clearance section, yes. I was feeling pretty good about the prices. I had it down to two pairs, and they were not on clearance, so I was then trying on those pairs, kind of trying to make a final decision.
That definitely hit a certain feeling in me. I am totally misunderstood. Even though I haven't communicated anything to staff, I feel misunderstood. I feel foolish. I feel like we went here to get a cheap pair of boots, and instead we're buying something outside of what I feel is in our budget. Again, that's the only thing I know. She doesn't know, well, Steph doesn't know anything about that. So I'm feeling foolish. Even though she is not doing this on purpose, I'm feeling a little bit controlled because she's made a decision. I kind of know my wife and I know where she's going with this, and I'm starting to feel control, and therefore I can't get it right. I don't measure up, or a lot of the beliefs that I am thinking right now. And I go into the whole manipulation phase, because I ended up going back into the clearance section and picking out boots for my wife.
Yes. So we're going to put another brick up. Mark's really doing a lot of justice right here. At this point, I am a very intuitive person. I can read Mark pretty well, and I'm starting to get a sense of what's going on, what's really going on, which is making me very edgy, very frustrated. I'm one that speaks my mind, and so when I see him and I see in his face that he's dealing with something and he's not choosing words, that just, I don't get it. And so I am definitely feeling I am right. He is being completely... what's the word I'm looking for? Yeah.
You're looking at the wrong guy.
Yeah. Irresponsible, I don't know, unrealistic. So I tried to explain to him, babe, you know my feet are very narrow. I can't just have any hiking boots. You know that we're going to be walking day in and day out for almost 2 weeks. And so there's definitely a self-righteousness. I go into kind of bossy mode, controls, a lot of stubborn for sure. And so in my way of acting, I could have very easily said to him, hey, what's going on? I can tell in your face that you're unsettled about something, but instead I choose to lob a brick his way.
Yeah, pretty much all these feelings are going through my head again. Definitely starting to feel like I'm not the problem. She's got to be, you know, she's got to change her mind. Somehow I have to influence that. Somehow I have to get her not to buy those boots. And so I go to some weapons of choice again. I get a little bit critical and manipulate. So I say, hey, you know, do whatever you want, but I'm out of here. And I left the store.
So when Mark left the store, what do you think he might have hit in me? My biggest one. I'm on my own. My husband just walked out the door, and now I have to make a choice of what's going on. Again, this example is minor. We're talking hiking boots here, but it definitely demonstrates that at this point, our barometers are very, very high. And so we get into full-blown bad Stephanie at this point. So we're talking critical, manipulation, justification. And I lob a brick over to him and actually follow him out of the store, find him on the sidewalk, and I just lay into him. I had received a Christmas bonus from my job. He also did. Mine was much greater than his. And he had chosen to spend his on something for himself. I didn't get anything. And so I just kind of lit into him about that. Why can't I spend $130 on these hiking boots? And it was a very volatile conversation at this point.
Yeah, and I'll just jump right to how did I handle that. You know, I became very defensive. Pleasing goes out the window. I know that's not going to work anymore, so I have to justify my behavior. And when she started talking about, you know, the money, the Christmas bonus and stuff like that, I'm like, that was already in the budget. We already knew how much you were going to make. And so that was going to Christian Ed. You know, my little $50 gift I just assumed I could use it on myself, but I actually shared it with the entire family. So again, kind of justifying and being very critical and defensive. That's how I chose to handle that situation, and it didn't make it any better at all.
So at this point, we get far down on the list for me, and I get to complete avoidance and silence and go into quiet mode. It was about a 45-minute drive home. No words were spoken. That is the ultimate wrath Mark can feel with me, is when I go into silence and I don't use my words. He knows that we're in a really bad place.
I tend to avoid, she does not.
Yes.
You pursue and I avoid. And so when she's avoiding and when she's not being intentional about communicating about something, I know that things are not going well.
So at that point we get home and we're making dinner. I'm in the kitchen making pasta, I remember it was spaghetti. And Mark is sitting at the dining room table working on something, and I'm sure I was the one that brought it up again. And at this point, Mark...
Well, the silence actually does me some good, actually bad. It's an opportunity for me to kind of load my guns, is what I like to say, is because I'm not one to be quick to speak and you know have all my thoughts and everything all planned out. Steph is very good at verbalizing what's going on in her head and her feelings. I'm not so good at that. So when we had about 45 minutes of quiet time is when I started just thinking, okay, I'm going to lose this battle of words and I'm going to lose it huge. So what can I say to kind of put it to end right away? And so when Steph brings this back up, I may have said something along the lines of, I always knew you were a spoiled brat.
Yeah, that didn't go over well.
No.
When he said that, I had a plastic spaghetti spoon in my hand, and I chucked it at him, and went upstairs, slammed the door to our bedroom, not once, not twice, but three times. At that point, the kids are crying. I was so infuriated that I couldn't even cry. And so that is the pinnacle of, you can see at this point, the wall is so high. And that's just kind of the example we wanted to talk through. A lot of people ask us, so did you buy the hiking boots? Yes, I bought the hiking boots. And actually this argument was defused pretty quickly. We were able to apologize, and at this point we can now very much laugh about it. Do you want to just talk a little bit about how it could have all been?
Right. If you go back to how we started this conversation about our houses, it really started with me avoiding effective communication with Steph. When I received that mail, that bill in the mail, I just kind of chose to say, hey, I can handle this. I've got it all under control. I can figure it out. And instead of just going to Steph and just saying, hey, you know, this month's budget's a little bit tight. Can we hold off any sort of, you know, spending at all that we can defer to another month? I mean, how receptive would you have been to that?
I would have been very receptive. However, the flip side of it is, as you can see, what Mark had lived with for many, many years wouldn't necessarily be a safe environment. And so I think at times he always had to weigh the benefits versus the risks. And he never knew when something would set me off. Oftentimes would characterize our marriage as walking on eggshells with me. So as much as he could have diffused the situation, I also had created kind of an unsafe space for him to do that. So we just want to quick go through just some things that this tool has brought to our marriage. It impacted our communication. It gave Mark, especially, but also myself, the words to describe exactly what was going on internally. Especially even in those situations where we've talked about, like, Mark's actually doing good things, and then if he's not getting something in return, that could sometimes be a trigger. So the ability to communicate those things, it's definitely revealing a lot about us. It's also made us better listeners, more active listeners, and also given us compassion with one another. Now that I know kind of the battle that Mark is going through in his mind, I'm very careful about how I speak to him, what words I use, not as a means of kind of tiptoeing around the minds in his life, but being sensitive to that, at the same time learning how to speak the gospel to get this out of his life, because this is not what God says about him. And part of my responsibility as a wife is to be that person that helps him get rid of that junk in his foundation. It's also given us just, I think, a lot of self-awareness of knowing what's going on, and also rooting out that selfishness that we had in our lives. So as much as the love languages, it's a beautiful thing to know that about our spouses, at the same time, really what's behind the motivation of what we're doing to love one another.
And also, one thing we want to be clear on is that you're never going to just be able to take away all these feelings inside of you. Your feelings are a part of being human, and that is not something that you're just going to master and keep under control and you're always going to have happy thoughts. No, that's not the goal. The goal is to really start down here and really think about, what are those beliefs, what are those lies that Satan has kind of crept in into your life, and that you just continually to respond in these ways. And so anytime that I respond with pleasing or manipulating, that's an opportunity for me to say, you know, not necessarily what's the feeling, but what's below that, what's the belief, what's going on in my head, what am I believing about myself or about Steph or about God that needs to change. That's the area of growth, I think, that could be really, really effective for all of us. And so if we go right on back to where we started, so if we're having issues with our will, with our chooser, we can't change our emotions, but the goal is to go all the way back and think, what's going on in your mind? The renewing of your mind is something that Paul talks about. And so that's what we want to also just try to emphasize. So for Steph and I, being a part of the marriage ministry, being naked and unashamed, Genesis 2:25 just talks about, that's in the garden how God describes their relationship. Not perfect, but naked and unashamed. And unashamed means that I would have that opportunity to go to Steph and say, this is the bill we just got in the mail. And I feel a little ashamed of myself that I wasn't well prepared for that. But will you journey that with me and allow us to make better decisions this month, or kind of push things off to the side till later? It gives us an opportunity. Unashamed, so I got to put my pleasing and my manipulating to the side. And if I do that, there's also redemption in asking for forgiveness. And so that's another growth area for us. Also in 2 Corinthians 10:5, it says, we take captive every thought and make it obedient to Christ. And so again, when we have those thoughts, sometimes we react quickly to them. Sometimes we have opportunities to sit back and think and kind of gospel ourselves. Steph talked about gospeling me when she sees that I'm being critical or I'm being defensive or I'm avoiding. That's her opportunity to hit pause and say, Mark, you know, what do you believe in right now? What's going on in your head? Can you share that with me? But you can also do that for yourself. If there's opportunity where you haven't overreacted right away, how could we take every thought captive? And then the last one is kind of a challenge from Jesus himself. In John 5, he sees a paralyzed man, and that paralytic, Jesus walks up to and says, do you want to get well? And that's kind of the challenge I gave to myself, is do I want to get well? Do I want to have a relationship with somebody where it's unashamed, where we can communicate? And even if I make mistakes, I know that it's okay. I'm not walking on eggshells. We can communicate effectively with one another and get over these bricks that we continue to lay, whether quickly or just because of a repeated pattern.
Yeah, I think that's a good point, because in all honesty, this right here becomes very, very comfortable for us. It's our default, and so that's a great point. Do you really want to get to the point where you're living a more peaceful life in the midst of the chaos? And then one last thought, oftentimes in our world, people will target the emotions. You just need to deal with your emotions and just be happier and your life will be happier. Or oftentimes they'll pick up the will. You just need to be a stronger person. This was definitely me pull up the bootstraps, be strong, be a big girl, and, you know, live a better life. And so what I love about this model is it, you know, comes back to what does the Bible say about renewing our minds. So anything, any last thoughts, or we're all set?
Okay.
Thank you so much, and we hope that this is a blessing and a great tool for you.